This is 10's late news with all the news you need. Tonight, turbulence on the tools. Key staff at our national carrier set to walk off the job tomorrow. What impact it will have on travelling footy finals fans. A warning for grand final ticket holders as hackers gain access to unique barcodes. An exclusion zone in Brisbane as fire burns through an industrial building. The Weather Bureau under fire after thousands warned of a tsunami threat that didn't exist. Could China spy on us through our cars? The US thinks so, and it's prompting questions here. Tomato trouble. The largest producer in Australia is plagued by a virus. What it means for prices. We meet the Brisbane man who made it his life's goal to get a significant AFL club's record acknowledged. Tuvalu takes its fight for lasting recognition to the UN as it battles the worst of climate change. The incredible moment a house succumbs to the ocean. And watch out, the risky job of supporting an octopus hunt for food.
Welcome to 10's Late News with Ursula Hayden.
First tonight, we are being warned flights across the country will be impacted tomorrow after Qantas staff voted to go on strike. It's the start of widespread action across the country over the next 2 weeks and will begin in Melbourne as thousands descend on the city ahead of the AFL Grand Final. Sam Mills is in Melbourne tonight for us. And Sam, what action is being taken?
Ursula, it's the Qantas Engineers Alliance, which says it's frustrated by the company's refusal to negotiate a fair deal, accusing Qantas of treating its engineers like garbage. Therefore, hundreds will take major strike action at all major airports over the next 2 weeks, beginning in Melbourne tomorrow. The alliance says that it's highly likely to affect Qantas flights in the capital cities. Now, Qantas has issued a statement tonight in response, saying it's putting contingencies in place and doesn't expect the strike will have an impact on customers, adding that it's held a series of meetings with the unions and made progress on a number of items and wants to reach an agreement that includes pay rises and lifestyle benefits for its people. Tomorrow is expected to be a busy day at Melbourne Airport with the school holidays in full swing and numbers of Sydney and Brisbane fans making their way into town for the AFL Grand Final on Saturday. Ursula.
Thanks, Sam. Now also of concern for footy fans, there's a chance their grand final tickets may have been stolen. People queued for days to get their hands on one of more than 100,000 tickets available for Saturday's game. The seats don't go on sale to the general public. Instead, they are divided between the AFL, club and MCC members and other corporate groups. It's those tickets allocated to corporate groups that were compromised earlier this week, with barcodes illegally downloaded by hackers. The number of affected tickets is thought to be in the low thousands. Earlier today, AFL CEO Andrew Dillon had this message for fans.
The grand final is a sellout, and any tickets that you're getting sold, if you're looking to purchase tickets now, be really careful about that because there is a chance that they won't be authorised tickets.
It's thought that scalpers were going to try to sell the stolen tickets online for steep markups, but the barcodes have now all been cancelled and will not get you into the gates on Saturday. New tickets will be issued to legitimate holders. Police are investigating. In developing news tonight, a man is in hospital with life-threatening burns after a fire erupted in a commercial building in the inner Brisbane suburb of Woolloongabba late this afternoon. More than a dozen fire crews are still battling that fire tonight, which has spread to a second building and caused smoke damage to a third. People inside this exclusion zone have been warned to stay indoors. So far, no evacuations have been ordered. The inferno is expected to burn for some time and paramedics remain on the scene. Meanwhile, it's a false emergency alert that had people talking up and down the East Coast. A tsunami warning issued by the Weather Bureau created momentary panic, which was then followed by a torrent of ridicule. The alert was sent to communities across Queensland and New South Wales and inland as far as Canberra.
A flood of warning messages for a tsunami that wasn't coming. Emergency text messages were received by people in Logan and landlocked Lithgow. In Eight Mile Plains, parts of New South Wales and Tasmania, and in Canberra, where grazing groups shared the warning in an area 200 kilometres from the sea. The text from the Bureau of Meteorology did contain the word test, but it was missed by many in the initial mayhem.
The test warnings were issued to the public via the bomb weather app in error.
It's funny like that. I definitely wouldn't have done. Yeah.
The threat was supposedly from an undersea earthquake, a magnitude 8.2, off New Zealand's South Island. It was cancelled within 2 minutes.
The Bureau acknowledges and apologises for any confusion that this test has caused.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. That's really good.
Panic and confusion quickly turned to humour. One social media user even marked themselves safe from harm in Canberra.
The Bureau of Meteorology says it was testing its new tsunami early warning system software through the bomb app between 11 a.m. and midday. It has apologised for any confusion it may have caused.
The bomb has faced a storm of controversy, a name change which failed, and flood warnings which came a day after communities in Cairns were cut off after ex-tropical cyclone Jasper. It was the far north's biggest disaster in a century.
It's another government department just doing government stuff. Yeah, just goes on. Where do you want to start?
A wave of controversy the bomb didn't see coming.
We are thoroughly investigating this error as part of our testing process.
Brendan Smith for 10 News First.
Your options to buy affordable electric vehicles could be slimming tonight, with increasing calls for Chinese-made cars to be banned on national security grounds. The US says it will enforce a ban on Chinese EVs within months, with Australia forced to consider whether it will follow suit.
It's the stuff of movie nightmares. Electric cars going haywire in a time of conflict. It's not crazy, says Australia's former cybersecurity chief, but the real risk comes from China.
There is a massive difference between made in China, which is perfectly fine, and controlled by China.
US President Joe Biden is racing through new laws before he leaves office, banning on national security grounds all Chinese-made vehicles that connect to the internet. That includes all EVs. Alistair McGibbon says not just cars, but cranes, batteries, even solar panels could be put to work against us in the event of major conflict.
The most significant risk is a catastrophic failing of our society through connected devices being controlled by a non-democratic nation.
Australia's Home Affairs Department says it is closely monitoring the US developments.
The future is here right now.
Boosting supply of affordable electric vehicles is central to the Albanese government's emissions reduction strategy. That vision relies on Chinese imports, already the third largest source country for all new sales.
The fact is that in a decade's time, you'll struggle to walk into a car yard like this and find something that's not an EV.
Intriguingly, China has banned Teslas operating near its sensitive sites. But the opposition is hesitant to pull the plug.
Do you think Australia should ban Chinese vehicles?
We're always going to be reticent to do something in the midst of a cost of living crisis that raises the cost of living.
Hugh Rimmington for 10 News First.
Australia's inflation rate has reached its lowest level for 3 years, a result of government rebates on electricity bills. Network political editor Ashley Raper joins me now for more on this. And Ash, before homeowners get too hopeful, the devil is in the detail here.
Yes, Ursula, don't get too excited just yet. This is monthly inflation data, which the Reserve Bank doesn't pay too much attention to because it bounces around and doesn't give a full picture as much as the quarterly data does. The figure that's come down to 2.7% is also headline inflation. And we know the RBA looks at underlying inflation, or core inflation, because that number takes out items that can fluctuate. And the Reserve Bank has been clear that it considers the cost of living relief, the energy bill subsidy, as a fluctuation because it's only in place for a year. So it temporarily brings down inflation when the RBA wants to ensure it's sustainably down. And the takeaway from that is that this new inflation data isn't going to speed up the timeline for a rate cut.
And Ash, negative gearing, it is a contentious issue here in Australia, but now the government is leaving open the possibility of making changes.
Yes, this is all very speculative, but it's generated quite a bit of chatter. Changing negative gearing isn't a new thought bubble for Labor. It took it to two elections, 2016 and 2019. Now, that was a shock loss in 2019, and negative gearing, along with other housing tax changes, was considered a big factor in that loss. So Labor abandoned it as a policy and has repeatedly said it's not something it's considering. But now Treasury has done modelling. We haven't seen this modelling. We don't know who ordered this modelling. The Albanese government is being really cagey about it. So let's have a listen to what they said.
Treasury, I'm sure, like other departments, do a range of proposals, policy, ideas. I want a public service that is full of ideas.
The sooner we phase out negative gearing and the capital gains tax discount, the sooner that millions of renters will finally have the chance to buy a home.
So the government insists this is not a life policy option, but it hasn't ruled it out either. And this is really interesting in the current climate. We just heard from the Greens spokesman, and Labor is battling the Greens on housing policy and legislation, and the Greens want changes to negative gearing. So do some other crucial crossbenchers. But we've also got an election looming, and while this will appeal to some younger voters, it is a risky policy if it was to be adopted again, because there's a lot of investors who negatively gear their properties, Ursula.
There certainly are. Thanks, Ash. A long-range missile has been fired by Hezbollah and intercepted over the Israeli city of Tel Aviv, marking a new escalation in the conflict. The missile was part of 40 launches sent from Lebanon, some of which saw debris fall in residential areas. Israel has also restarted extensive attacks in just the past few hours, with strikes in southern Lebanon and the Bekaa Valley, as well as a town north of Beirut. At least 10 more people have been killed, although that is likely to rise. Lebanon's foreign minister is pleading for international pressure to stop Israel as the country's hospitals become overwhelmed.
A diplomatic solution is still possible. In fact, it remains the only path to lasting security